the big announcement is there's going to be a communion at 2 p.m. after lunch today. So that'll be the main thing to get ready for. There will be no video because of the communion, the 4:30 video. Sunday evening Bible class will be held Thursday evening at 6 p.m. prayer meeting and Bible study. And I think he said there was no, down here said no food bank this week. I've already mentioned the communion at 2 p.m. And down here at the end, it talks about the sundown. This Sabbath is 9:06. Next Friday is 9:04. That means it's going to start getting shorter, the days. So we have the longest day, or more or less, right now. I think that does it for the announcements. We'll continue with our worship service.
Righteous Father, we're so thankful to be in your house on your holy day. Lord, we pray that you will bless us. Bless us with the presence of your Spirit, that we may worship you in spirit and in truth. That our worship will be acceptable in your sight. And that all that we say and do will bring honor and glory to you, is our prayer in Christ's name. Amen. Be seated, please. Before I turn the time over to Walter to do our praise section, I want to welcome our visitors. We have several, and we're glad you're here. Leone, we're glad you're here, not for the reason, but that you're here. And Edgar, we're glad you're here. But I want to thank God that someone that's been missing for a few months is here. Lewis, welcome. We're glad you're here.
Yeah.
After an extended illness, and we lost track, but we found where he was, and now we're glad that he's here. We're so thankful for each one of you worshiping with us. May the Lord bless you.
Well, our scripture of praise is found in Isaiah 43, verse 1. Isaiah 43, verse 1. Isaiah 43, verse 1 says, "But now, thus saith the Lord, who created you, O Jacob, and he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine." Yes.
You are mine.
Yes. You know, when you think about the weapons God has given us, spiritual weapons, certain things come together, like joy counters stress. The thing that counters bitterness is praise. And as we start off our praise section, I want to start off with a testimony of how a gentleman overcame bitterness. In school, I met a girl who gave a powerful testimony of her father, who was a Vietnam veteran. And looking back at kind of how things turned out, he's a very loving man, but he could have been very, very bitter due to situations of how Americans treated him and other soldiers personally coming back from Vietnam. The man spoke about how for many years he was afraid and ashamed to even wear his BDUs in public, because he didn't want to get ridiculed, didn't want to get spit on, didn't want to get attacked, rocks thrown at him. But he never got bitter, and still to this day he's a very joyful man. But what he always wanted the world to know was the other side of that story was he didn't even want to go. He was drafted, like many others who was there. But he was attacked, you know. And we, as we all know, many people who were over there seen and experienced things that depleted their lives, you know, and they became very bitter. But this man, by the glory of God, was able to counter bitterness with praise. You know, we celebrate Veterans Day openly now, but for a while, that was something that was considered taboo and suppressed to VA hospitals. But now, soldiers can walk openly with their BDUs. At this time, we turn it over to the congregation for testimony and praise. Just to close off the session of praise, Forbes magazine has declared that the most powerful, most influential man on the earth right now is the Pope. You know, God has made it clear church and state are to be separate, but it's coming closer and closer together. The owner of Google met at the Vatican. The owner of Apple met at the Vatican. I mean, from every angle, these things are being tied together. But praise God, this is all signs that it is soon, very soon, that he shall come and rip open the clouds, and we'll see him live and live in color. To start off with our opening hymn, we'll have Rosalind sing, "I Sing the Mighty Power of God," number 93. Please stand.
Yeah. Our scripture this morning is Revelation 2, verses 1 to 4. When you have it, say amen.
Amen.
If you don't have it, say grace, mercy, mercy.
Amen.
Revelation 2, 1 to 4. And unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write these things, saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. I know thy works, and thy labor, and thy patience, and how thou came not, canst not bear them which are evil. Thou hast tried them which say they are apostles, but are not, and hast found them liars, and hast borne, and hast patience for thy name's, for my name's sake, hast labored, and hast not fainted. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his word. Are there special request for prayer this morning and receive the Lord in prayer?
Daniel.
Yeah, I had him written down here. Any others?
And Ted and Angel, they're home because Angel is sick.
Okay.
Mr. Fred,
Mr. Lewis Holden.
Lewis is here.
I understand that.
But we want to keep praying for him.
Toting a tank around with him and has been fighting battle with pneumonia for some time, I think, so. And our pastor and our daughter had serious health issues, and Charles and Esther's daughter. There are a number that need the Lord's intervention.
Everybody's dog.
Our daughter was diagnosed with scleroderma last few days. They say there's not any way to cure that. Along with dermatomyositis and a whole list of things that most of you know about. Let's kneel as we seek the Lord in prayer. Merciful Heavenly Father, we come before you entreating your grace, your mercy to us, asking your forgiveness for our sins individually and collectively, that we may be made worthy to come into your presence. Cover us with the robe of Christ's righteousness, we pray. You have heard these names that are on our prayer list, and we know there are many others, many that are not spoken. And we praise your name for the miracles that we have seen. We pray now that you will bless Dr. Charles as he breaks the bread of life to us. Use him as your servant to speak your words. And on our minds and our eyes and our ears, that we may see and hear and understand what we have for us. Help us to be a blessing to those we come in contact with our community, with our nation, with the world around us. Help us to get, with your blessing, this commission to carry the gospel to the whole world finished soon. Please put a stop to all the meanness and the corruption that's going on in this world. Thank you now, we pray and praise your name, in Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
it's time for our offering today, and the conference has sent out these little readings to give us ideas of what to talk about. And of course, it's for the local church budget today. It starts out with a scripture, Proverbs 3:5 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths." I'm sure that each one of us wants the Lord to direct our paths.
Yeah.
Sometimes we don't know what to do we? Solomon defines and exemplifies what he meant by trusting the Lord. He alludes to the Shema, which is a Hebrew word that I don't happen to know, but it's also known as the Jewish central prayer. The prayer should be the starting point of all believers. This prayer should be the starting point of all believers. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. So Solomon describes three specific pillars of trust. Believers know that they trust the Lord when they honor him with their possessions. Trust is also built when believers submit to God's correction. And finally, believers who trust the Lord use their time to bless others. Now, Solomon assures Christians that trusting God will prolong life and bring prosperity. Would you trust God today? Trust him with all you. Trust him. Trust that he will fill your barns with overflowing. Trust that your vats will be brim over as the honor, as you honor God with your means. Trust that the Lord will use your offering today to meet the needs of this congregation. Trusting God brings the knowing, and knowing has evidence. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in him. That's Psalms 34:8. So those are some good thoughts that we have for trusting the Lord. And Father in heaven, we thank you for your many promises, promises of blessing as we trust you. In Jesus' name.
This song really ministers to me, and I hope it ministers to you as well. Life.
inspired in song, and thank you, Nathan, for what you do in our music.
Amen.
I invite you to take your Bibles today. We're going to look at several parables or stories in the Bible. Take your Bibles and open them to the text that J.D. read, Revelation 2. While you're doing that, I want to set the stage for the reading of it. John the Apostle became apostle as a young man in his 20s. He would have to have been only in his 20s to still be alive in the 90s of the first century. John was the apostle and the only one of the 12 at the foot of the cross. He got to the foot of the cross with Jesus' mother, and because he was there and not deserving, was loyal, Jesus asked him to take care of his mother. And from that day on, John took the mother of Jesus home to live with him wherever he was. John ended in Ephesus toward the end of his life. Mary, the mother of Jesus, according to tradition, died in Ephesus because that's where John lived. That meant that was where Mary lived. Where is Ephesus? It's in the western part of Turkey. It's quite a ways from Jerusalem, quite a ways from the cross. To turn to Ephesus, it was a great city, a port city. But toward the end of John's life, the emperor of Rome wanted John dead. They tried, according to the traditional story, is they tried to boil him in oil. They say all that oil did was probably made his old arthritic joints feel better. As they tried to heat him up in the oil, the Lord would not let him die. So they banished him to the Isle of Patmos. He's alone. No church. No loved one. No friends. And God gives him a vision. And while there in that vision, he is watching. Jesus must be dictating a letter to him. Why do I think it's dictating? If you open your Bibles to Revelation 2, and if your Bible is a red letter edition, it says those are the words of Jesus. And if those are the words of Jesus, in around 91 or 92 AD, they had to be dictated to John. For John wrote them down. And John begins to write to the angel of the church of Ephesus, write. Let's bow our heads for a moment of prayer. Our loving Father, as we open your word, we pray that you will bless us today. With the presence of your Spirit, open our hearts, open our minds, that we may understand your word, that we may understand your will, and your love for us is our prayer in Christ's name. Amen. Unto the angel of the Church of Ephesus write these things, said, he who holds the seven stars in his right hand, and that's Jesus, who walks in the midst of the seven golden lampstands, and that was Jesus. I know your works, your labor, your patience, that you cannot bear those who are evil. And you have tested those who say they are apostles and are not, and have found them liars. And you have persevered, and have patience, and have labored for my name's sake, and have not become weary. Nevertheless, I have this against you, that you left your first love. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen. Repent and do the first works, or else I will come to you quickly and remove your lampstand from its place, unless you repent. But this you have, that you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. You as near, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him that overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. That's the letter. And as John was penning this, as the Lord would be dictating it to him, I'm certain that John was thinking, this is my church. I'm the pastor of this church. And this church, the Lord says, has lost its first love. And this church, which is my church, I go there, I pastor it, is going to have its lampstand removed. What did that mean? The lampstand stood for the churches. You find that in Revelation 1, verse 20. Look back a few verses. You can read that. My church can be removed. Why? Because it has lost its first love. But the church had a lot going for it. He says, I know your works. This is Jesus talking. Your labor, your patience, that you cannot bear those that are evil, and you have tested those who say they are apostles and found them liars. You know God's word. You have tested them to the law and to the testimony. And if they spoke not according to it, you knew they were liars. Our church today has done the same thing. We can look out over the Christian world and we hear preacher after preacher preaching from God's word things that are not true. Things that bring false hope. And we've looked at them and we've said, we know you're not telling the truth. We've done the same thing. Lord says, I know your works. We know that churches that teach that their second chances is a devil's deception. We know that there are those that believe, once I'm saved, it doesn't matter what I do, I can go ahead and lie and steal. I still have my ticket punched, I'm going to the pearly gates. We're going to read some texts that deny that in a few minutes. We know those are not God's words. We have read them in God's word. We know what it says. And only those that are obeying the Lord, only those that have fully surrendered to the Lord, not held back part of their lives to do whatever they want to and won't relinquish it to the Lord. We know they're not going to be in God's kingdom according to the Bible and the verses we're going to read yet ahead. What a burden to John. This is my church. And they've lost their first love. What does it mean to lose your first love? That's what we're going to look at today as we go now to Matthew 7. If you have your Bibles, I invite you. Go to Matthew 7, the last part of the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus has been telling us throughout this entire Sermon on the Mount what it's like to be a citizen of God's kingdom. He has described them in the Beatitudes, the steps taken to be there. He has described through various illustrations how the citizen lives in this world in relation to others. How the citizen of the kingdom worships and how they pray. And then we look at verse 21 through 22. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. What did he just say? Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom. Let's pay attention. What did he mean? Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? Cast out demons in your name? And done many wonders in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. Is Jesus telling us that some religious people, very religious, very active in the church, he doesn't know? I never knew you? What does he mean by that? Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name and cast out demons in your name? I want you to tuck that behind one ear. We're coming back to that in just a few moments. Okay? As we continue, look here at what the Lord says. Now I invite you to turn your Bibles to Matthew 25. Matthew 25 is right after and part of the chapter on signs of the second coming of Jesus. And included in those signs were the signs of the destruction of Jerusalem, which happened in 70 AD. It happened in the Apostle John's lifetime, because we're coming back to him in a moment too. Matthew 25, right after those signs, Jesus gives this story, starting with verse 31. When the Son of Man comes in His glory, and all the holy angels with Him, then He will sit on the throne of His glory. All the nations will be gathered before Him, and He will separate them one from another as a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats. He will set the sheep on the right, on his right hand, but the goats on the left. Then the king will say to those on the right hand, come you blessed of my Father. Inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me. Then the righteous will answer and say, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you? Or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and take you in, or naked and clothe you? Or when did we see you sick or in prison and come to you? And the king will answer and say to them, assuredly I say to you, inasmuch as you have did it to one of the least of these, my brethren, you did it to me. Really? Here are those going in the kingdom. They fed the Lord. They clothed the Lord. They missed him in prison. They didn't know when they did that. Here are those we read in Matthew 7. Lord, Lord, didn't we prophesy? Didn't we cast out demons in your name? One group standing before Jesus is saying, here's my resume, Lord. This is what I did. Here's my report card. This is all that I did for you. Look at all that I did. And the others, Lord, we don't remember doing. Is there something that puts these two together? I believe so. Let's read the rest of the story. Then he will say to those on the left hand, depart from me, you cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was hungry and you gave me no food. Thirsty and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger and you did not take me in. Naked and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison and you did not visit me. They will also answer and say, Lord. Interesting. They're calling him Lord. They have been calling him Lord. But doing nothing. When did we see you hungry? Or thirsty? Or a stranger, or naked, or sick in prison, and did not minister you? Then he will answer them, saying, assuredly, I say to you, inasmuch as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. And these will go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. One group is calling the Lord, feeding the Lord, visiting the Lord when he's in need. The other never did. But the one group didn't know they were doing it. They never saw Jesus that way. The other never saw Jesus in those in need. John says, wrote in the book of the book of Revelation, in the letter to Ephesus, said, you have lost your first love. What is the first love? How is it fit into the two little stories we just read? Well, let's look at the third one. The third one. also in Matthew 25, right after the signs of the second coming of Jesus. This is to help us remember to be ready. Starting with verse 1. Then the kingdom of heaven shall be likened to 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. Now 5 of them were wise, and 5 were foolish. Those who were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. But while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight, a cry was heard. Behold, the bridegroom is coming. Go out to meet him. Then all those virgins rose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said to the wise, give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out. But the wise answered, saying, no, lest we should not, there should not be enough for us and you, but go rather to those who sell and buy for yourselves. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went in with him to the wedding, and the door was shut. Afterward, the other virgins came also, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he answered and said, assuredly I say to you, I do not know you. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man comes. What's the meaning of this story? What is that oil? We understand in Scripture oil stands for the Holy Spirit. And I'm going to give you one caution. Now, in just a moment here, I want you to think. When you are studying a parable, the parable is given a story to tell, a lesson. Don't try to push it beyond that lesson, because they don't always walk on all fours. Jesus is telling us a lesson. This is based on things that happened in his day, how the bridegroom would come, and the customs of the times. I won't go into the details on the customs of the times. But here we read in verse 8, and the foolish said to the wise, give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out. But the wise answered, saying, no, lest there should not be enough for us. They couldn't give if they wanted to. The Holy Spirit in your life, you cannot give it to somebody else. Only the Holy Spirit can come into your heart. You do not have control over the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit has to have control over you. They could not give. It wasn't that they were selfish and hoarding for themselves. I cannot bring salvation to my children. They have to make that arrangement with God themselves. Oh, I wish I could. How much I wish I could. But you can't. All I can do is pray and witness. And pray and witness. The Holy Spirit must come into the life and change the life. The life is changed by the Holy Spirit. Your life, my life. Till we become more and more like Jesus. I want to go back to John, to Revelation, rather. John the Revelator. John the Revelator wrote in that first letter, a letter to his church, a letter that was personal. He was the pastor. A letter from Jesus, he took dictation. You have lost your first love. What is your first love? I invite you to go with me to Matthew 5. This one's important. Turn to it. Matthew 5. When you start at the first of the chapter, the first things you run into are the Beatitudes. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Those that understand and know that they have nothing spiritually. They are lost. They have a poverty of spirit. Because we're lost, we're sinners. And when they recognize that, and ask God, because they are now mourning that fact. Blessed are they that mourn. Once they have understood that fact, and they mourn that they don't have anything they can offer God. And they ask for forgiveness, God forgives them. And he begins with the Holy Spirit to change the lives. And the Beatitudes are step by step is how God does it. So we come to Beatitude number 3. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Once the Lord has changed you and forgiven you, you have nothing, nothing to boast about. You're meek. Jesus said, I am meek and lowly in heart, to Matthew 11. You become like him. Then comes Beatitude number 4. Verse 6. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Here is our first love. Once we have met Jesus, we can't get enough of him. I remember when I fell in love with Esther. Every time I could, I wanted to be with her. I lived across the street from a girl's dorm. That was convenient. I could see her on campus. She came over to the house. There's an experience called first love. With Jesus, it's hungry and thirsting for his righteousness. Because we can't get enough of him. We want to know more about him. We want to spend time with him. But now I want you to notice something. This is very critical to what we're trying to cover tonight. I want you to look at verse 10. Matthew 5, verse 10. J.D., read it loud and clear. Matthew 5:10. Can you read it loud and clear?
Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
We just read in verse 6, blessed are they that hunger and thirst for righteousness. J.D. just read in verse 10, blessed are they that are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Somewhere between verse 6 and verse 10, we find the description of Christ's righteousness. Have you ever thought about that? Let's look at those. There's three of them. Blessed are the merciful. And in Matthew 6, we have to just read what Jesus said about prayer. We need to be able to forgive others. If we don't forgive others, the Lord's going to forgive us as we forgive those others in the same way. Once you have obtained mercy from God and had your sins forgiven, God expects us to forgive others. Because the Holy Spirit is changing our lives. We have been hungry and thirsting for righteousness, and the first thing that comes is forgiveness toward others, compassion to others. I was hungry, and you fed me. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. Compassion becomes part of the righteousness of Christ as it fills your life. Blessed are the merciful. You can't be merciful unless you receive mercy. But once you have received mercy, you become compassionate and merciful to others as Jesus was compassionate and merciful to you. You now see others in a different light. I was hungry, and you gave me food. And I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. When, Lord? When did we do that? We did that when we did it to somebody we didn't know was representing Jesus. By doing it to others, we know, because of the compassion of the Holy Spirit in our life, reaching out to others, we are doing what Jesus would have done. And that's the same as doing it unto Him. Verse 8. Blessed are the pure in heart. You cannot have a pure heart unless you found out to start with you don't have one. And you mourn the fact that you didn't have one. And you've asked the Lord to cleanse my heart, as the psalmist says, cleanse me. Cleanse my heart. Make it pure. Create in me a pure heart. Found in the 51st Psalm. The Lord wants to create in us a pure heart. That's the second part of the righteousness of Christ that He wants to build into our lives. What a beautiful thought. That pure heart is not mine, that's Jesus' heart. He wants to put it there. He wants to transform it. We're going to get into that too in a moment. Third, blessed are the peacemakers. You will not be a peacemaker unless you crucify self. Blessed are the meek. Meek have crucified self. They have nothing to boast about. For everything has been done for them by Jesus. And we have set self aside and filled our lives with the Holy Spirit. That oil that filled five of the virgin's lamps. The critical part was when it was needed. If you have surrendered totally, completely to the Holy Spirit, you will have oil. in your lamp when Jesus comes. And you will be merciful. And you will add up your heart. And you will be a peacemaker, because a peacemaker cannot make peace if he is concerned about himself. Someone's going to say something. The irritate self. Somebody may call you something that bothers you enough. And you want to get even. That's not peacemaking. When the Holy Spirit is transforming you, he wants to make you like Jesus. Here, in these three Beatitudes. Blessed are the merciful. Blessed are the pure in heart. Blessed are the peacemakers. Is the best description for true righteousness. Because once you have it, Jesus said in the next Beatitude, blessed are those who are persecuted because they are righteous. Beatitude number 4, you're searching for it. Beatitude number 8, you have it. In between is what it is, the righteousness of Christ in you. We're told in Revelation, John is told that he needs to bring his church back to their first love. He says, do the former things. That's what Jesus is saying. Do the former things. If you've ever had a first love experience with Jesus, you need to make sure you still do. You know, as time goes along, sometimes marriages go through a little time in which we put up with each other instead of love each other. But then as we get older and get more dependent on each other, it's back to that first love experience. Some never have lost it. Some have that little time in between the first love and the first love repeated. As Christians, we need that first love. Either the first love or the first love repeated in our life. When Jesus comes, I invite you to turn to Romans, the 8th, I mean the 12th chapter. Romans 12. We've been studying Romans lately. This particular verse is totally captivating. Starting with verse 1. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God. Our worship is to be a worship with sacrifices, but our sacrifice is our self. We give ourselves totally and completely to God, a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is our reason. And then Paul says, do not be conformed to this world. The interesting thing about that word conformed means schematic. That's what we get our word schematic from, this particular Greek word. And a schematic is a plan, an outline of something. The Lord has a plan for us, but the devil has one. Don't be conformed to the devil's plan in this world. The Lord says through Paul, but be transformed. And that word is so fascinating. The Greek word is metamorpho. We use metamorphosis to talk about between the caterpillar and the butterfly, the transition, the most dramatic change in all of creation between a butterfly and a caterpillar. two totally different lifestyles. Two totally different life entities. One, eat of leaves. All kinds of ugly feet. No, they just don't look pretty. Transformed into a body that no longer can handle that. No, that food, they eat. They live on nectar. Beautiful wings, they fly. They're no longer grounded. They have so many different things. The beautiful eyes that they have. Oh, they're able to smell better. They're able to do all kinds of things. God wants to transform us. And if He is transforming us, we need to have that first love experience. We need to be totally searching and hunting for righteousness, which is Jesus. We need to be captivated in our lives, wanting to know more about Jesus. Then we have that first love. And if we have that first love, that righteousness of Jesus will become part of us as the Lord changes us, transforms us into something new. No longer a sinful human being, but a righteous, God-fearing citizen of the kingdom with an eternity for a future. And the very last part of that transformation, when that butterfly comes out of that chrysalis, which was a cocoon, a casket for the caterpillar, and a launching pad for the butterfly. When that butterfly comes out, it's represented in my mind, found in 1 Corinthians 15. Well, I show you a mystery. We shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. When Jesus comes, you'll either be resurrected with a new body and a new eternity, or you'll be translated, changed immediately in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye of your life when He comes, so that you too can join in that eternity. What a change. That's because once you have been searching and hunting for Jesus, more of Him because you can't get enough of Him, that first love, that compassion for others, will cause you never to tell God, "I cast out demons for you. I perform miracles for you." We'll never give God a resume of all the great things we did when we looked at how much God has done for us. Say, "Lord, I have nothing to offer but myself." And the Lord will take care of the rest. You may cast out demons. You may perform miracles in the name of Jesus, but you'll never break that because you will be 100% totally surrendered to the love of Jesus. When Jesus comes, He then will say, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." Hymn number 541. Lift up the trumpet, loud let it ring.
Amen.
Jesus is coming again. We need that first love experience. We need that compassion that Jesus has. We need the righteousness of Christ in our lives. And it's all available. And we're the only ones standing in the way, if anyone's standing in the way. Amen. item number 541. We're going to sing the first and the last stanzas. Remember the communion service this afternoon, right after our lunch.
Jesus.
going to use all the help we can get of this new talent that's been showing up. Bless us in our worship and to bless us otherwise. And I pray the Lord will continue to bless this church. Shall we stand as we seek the Lord? Loving Father, we're so thankful to be here tonight. We thank you that we have this opportunity to share together the emblems of our Lord's body and shed blood for our sins. Father, we know that you gave us Jesus because you loved us. You loved us so that you gave us your only begotten Son. As we contemplate and think on this wonderful gift and your wonderful love and this horrible sacrifice that was required for us, be saved. We want to thank you, and we pray that you will bless us with your Spirit as our prayer in Christ. Amen. Be seated, please. You all are going to bring us our devotion.
It's definitely a blessing to be up here. It's definitely been a blessing to be up here. My first time I was involved in communion was 6 years ago when I entered the church. Ralph Harmon gave me the opportunity. With that said, I just want to give a brief testimony and just tie this all together. By the time my mom had me, my dad was on his deathbed. I'm actually youngest of nine, but two died. And it seemed like as much as my mom worked, it still wasn't a lot. I grew up fairly poor, right off the Amarillo Boulevard. And I remember being 10 years old, and it was on a Friday evening. Just kind of life as usual. My mom, I would say she was a religious person, but we didn't have a structured religion anyway, you know. But I remember not having any food in the house, and she says, come on, put your shoes on, we're gonna go get some food. This is when I was 10 years old. And we walked from our house on William Street to Little Caesars. And at that time, they had these huge pizzas called Bigfoots. And we got two Bigfoots, two Crazy Breads, and two liters. And I remember crossing the boulevard, I headed back home, and my mom started crying. She said, I'm going to jail. Because I just wrote a hot check. And I remember getting back to the house, and all my siblings, everybody's just excited, everybody's eating. But there was like a sense of danger that I had, because I truly believed my mom was, she was going to jail. But I watched my other siblings just eat and carry on. But no one really knew or had the knowledge of the immense sacrifice that my mom had made to get that pizza and felt like the way she was going to pay it back, she was going to jail. And it makes me think of Hosea 4:6, which says, my people perish for a lack of knowledge. Now, we know somebody unfortunately died today and didn't know about the Sabbath, didn't know about the state of the dead. But they're asleep, and they're going to be in heaven when Christ comes back. So this knowledge cannot simply be the Sabbath. It cannot simply be the state of the dead. This knowledge has to be an acknowledgement of all that God has been through to save mankind. You can't appreciate the cross if you don't understand and have a knowledge of what all Christ, the Father, the Holy Spirit, yea, even the angels have been through to save mankind. And I take that and I think about the Last Supper. You know, Jesus' death, it was cruel, it was immense, and for us it was necessary. But did a true understanding of what that sacrifice meant, did it hover over the disciples? Or were they like my siblings, partaking, unaware of the risk, the torment, the absolute chain reactions that would change their life for the rest of their lives? You know, Zechariah 13:6 says, "And one shall say unto him, What are these wounds in thy hands? Then shall he answer, Those which I was wounded in the house of my friends." You know, there's an old saying that old people say, with friends like these, we don't need enemies. John 20, verse 27 says, "Then saith he to Thomas, Reach hither thy finger, and behold my hands, and reach hither thy hand, and thrust it into my side." Revelation 5, 6, John says, "I seen a lamb as if it was slain." Now, the common factor of all three of these verses is the fact that Jesus resurrected and yet still bore the permanent scars of humanity, as he has permanently taken on humanity. As we partake of the bread, understand that as we stroll through heaven, perfectly symmetrical, perfectly proportional, your God will forever be deformed. In Acts chapter 23, verses 12 through 13, a group of men, they bound themselves together and said, none of us is going to eat or drink until we take Paul's life. Well, it goes without saying that fast miserably failed. But there's a fast that was going on before that fake fast, and it's still going on to this day. Matthew chapter 26, verse 26 to 29. "And as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, Take and eat, this is my body. And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, Drink ye all of it, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." Jesus has been fasting. But what does that mean? This is a very deep situation. But I'll tell you one aspect of it. Leviticus 17:11 says the life is in the blood. And before sin, King Jesus was the king of the universe. And right now he's fasting from being king. He's saying, I will not be king again until you enter the kingdom with me. Right now I'm going to be a high priest. So he's fasting from being the king that he is. And he's simply being a high priest. And I end with this. The 144,000, they're going to have an understanding of this sacrifice. That is a symbolic number. It's almost like if you think of an election, God needs 144,000 electoral votes to vote him in as king. What do you say? Heavenly Father, Lord God, thank you. This is a precious time. It's bittersweet, though. I hate what happened to you, because I know you hurt just as much as you saw what we did to Jesus. I know you hurt, Father. But at the same time, by his stripes we are healed. We needed it. Lord God, show us just a little bit of the appreciation needed to truly show gratitude towards the cross. But not just the cross and the outer court, Lord, for that blood was taken into the most holy place. And that blood is transforming. We are the people of the judgment. The people who will live at this time and reflect your character fully. But when you placed your image on Adam, he failed you. Thus, you will have a generation on this earth who will stand where Adam failed, without a mediator, and in the great controversy forever. Please let us be a part of that plan. In Jesus Christ, precious and holy name we pray, in his meek and lowly character, we do say, amen.
Separate for the reading in 1 Corinthians 11. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Those of us at the table will kneel as we pray. Our loving Father, we're thankful that this body of yours was broken. Though it hurts us, pains us to think of what you did, but because you loved us, your body was broken. Because you loved us, you had to suffer pain and torture. Father, we are so thankful for that love. That death on the cross paid our penalty. Lord, you made it possible because of your love that we may live through eternity. For that, we are thankful. As we remember this solemn occasion, time in which our Creator took our place, we pray for your blessing. It's our prayer in Christ. Amen. Jesus said, "This is my body, which is broken for you."
Matthew chapter 26, starting with verse 27. Then he took the cup, and gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for the remission of sins. Those at the table will kneel for prayer. Good afternoon, Heavenly Father. In the name of Jesus Christ and through the power of your Holy Spirit, we humbly come before the throne of grace with an attitude of thanksgiving. Lord God, give us the courage to live the Christian life, which is our reasonable service, the minimum of our reasonable service. The time is close, near, even at the door. Father Jesus said, when you come back, will he find faith? Please bless everyone in this building, Lord, to live a faithful life, to show appreciation for the death of heaven's treasure, your Son. Lord God, as we partake symbolically, let this blood run through us, Lord. The blood of Jesus, give us his mind. Shed heavenly light on us, Lord. We need to understand these things. For your people perish due to a lack of knowledge of the plan of salvation. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' sweet name, we honor him. Amen.
All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who will declare his generation? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgressions of my people, he was stricken. And while they made his grave with the wicked, but with the rich at his death, because he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He has put him to grief. When you make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days. And the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Drink all of it. You will not drink of the fruit of the vine again until we drink it together. shall see the labor of his soul and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant shall justify many. For he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will divide him a portion with the great. And he shall divide the spoil with the strong. Because he poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bore the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. Says they sang a song and went out. Let's sing the old rugged.
All the glory belongs to you.